Thank you very much, Azra. Joining us this evening for a quick chat on COVID-19 is Professor Indika Karunathilake, President of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. A very good evening to you and welcome, Professor Karunathilake. Starting off, Sri Lanka has done comparatively well than other nations when it comes to COVID-19 since the first victim was detected on the 11th of March. Can we safely say that Sri Lanka is now not in a bad position as we expected before?
So let me put it in this way, Shamil. When we compare with other countries, we can say that Sri Lanka has done exceptionally well. And it's evident by the numbers as well. And the credit should go to the government and the health authorities, the triforces, law enforcement, and especially the health workers and professionals and the citizens of the country. However, I would like to attribute the major part of the credit to the very strong public health system in Sri Lanka. For this disease doesn't have any definitive cure. There are no vaccines. The only way to prevent the spread is through preventive measures. And Sri Lanka has a very strong system that emphasizes disease prevention, sanitation, and basic hygiene. Those are the most important aspects that you need to prevent the spread of this disease.
So, starting from the 11th of March to date, we have only less than 100 cases, confirmed cases thus far.
Correct.
Is it a time to be complacent about the situation and think, okay, Sri Lanka is on the right track, hence we can go out, we can violate curfew rules, so on and so forth? Is this a time to think like that?
Absolutely not. I would say this is a time to be more vigilant because there are many reasons. One is this virus is very virulent, very infectious. And secondly, the numbers that we are seeing today is the infection that has happened or taken place about maybe few days or 2 weeks before maximum because of the incubation period. The infection that is happening right now would be evident in only in 1 week's time or 2 weeks' time. But by that time, it would have reached more patients. So I don't think we can be complacent. This time to be vigilant, and the most important thing is we need to stick to the guidelines and the advice of the health authorities. And the most important step that we need to take is we need to detect patients and isolate the contacts and prevent the spread.
Professor Karunathilake, when you look at the world, you see Boris Johnson now being infected with COVID-19. Yes. We saw Prince Charles being infected with COVID-19. Does the Sri Lankan public health system allow individuals or doctors to reveal the names of those who are infected for the betterment of the community at large? Because it may help for individuals who are in direct contact with a patient to come out and say, okay, I have had direct contact, so I have to be on self-quarantine. Does the public health system in Sri Lanka allow that during a situation of a pandemic?
Yes, more than a legal enforcement, divulging the patient confidentiality or the information is against medical ethics. It's a breach of medical ethics as a violation, as well as a violation of the country's law. Because we might think in that way we might be able to find out what are the contacts. But on the other hand, what will happen is through this violation, we are creating a stigma. And because of this stigma, the patients will not be able to, they would not like to come out with their information or the true details. And that has happened many times in the hospitals. And that had led to catastrophic situation in the hospitals. So the best thing that we can do is ensure confidentiality and have trust on the health system. Because as I mentioned previously, we have a very strong public health system who are capable of identifying the contacts and then take the necessary measures like quarantine or isolation. It has happened already.
Let's look at the world now, Professor Karunathilake. As you speak about the situation in Sri Lanka, the situation in the world is quite dire.
Yes.
Let's talk about Wuhan. It was the epicenter before, then it shifted to Italy and then subsequently to Spain. And now the epicenter seems to be New York, the United States of America. So the virus does not have any boundaries.
It does not.
So how can we manage this menace if there is no boundaries, there is no restrictions? How can we as a nation prevent something of this sort coming into our shores again.
Yes, you are very correct in saying that it doesn't have boundaries and it spread very fast. First, let me explain why this is spreading very fast. One reason is this is a new virus. That's why we call it novel coronavirus. And since it is so new, people are getting exposed to that virus only now. And there is no immunity. For other viruses, they have been exposed for years and years or even for centuries. So we have immunity. For this new virus, we don't have immunity. Therefore, if we allow it to spread, this virus will spread unstoppably, continuously. It goes like generally, worldwide research data says that one infected person can infect up to 2 to 5 persons. In general, it can be even more. So if you...
The GMO in Sri Lanka says at least 500 people could be infected if one person is infected with COVID-19.
Extreme situation, it may be possible. Something like that has happened in Korea as well. But generally, in one cycle, one patient would infect about 2 to 5 people. That's the general research findings worldwide. I mean, research findings are also emerging worldwide. So even if we think of that scenario, even that simple scenario, one person infecting 2 people, if you go on like that, it will be doubling. So it goes like 2, 4, so on and so forth. So within few short cycles, it can engulf the whole area or the whole world. So that is why it's so important to prevent. So if you allow this uncontrollable spread, it will happen. So to break it, only thing that you can do is avoid getting infection by avoiding going to public places, avoid basic hygiene like hand washing, so on and so forth, identify the contacts, isolate them. In that way, you can break the cycle.
Professor Karunathilake, if you look at the world, many say that pandemics of this sort is cyclic. In 1918, we saw the Spanish flu claiming the lives of approximately around 17 million people and infecting around 500 million people. And Sri Lanka was among the top countries that was infected with the virus, and the number of deaths from Sri Lanka that emerged in 1920 was quite significant. Is this pandemic something to worry about of this sort, or have we passed beyond that stage and are we looking at something which would last for the next 2 years or 3 years per se? When will we see an end, basically? That's the question.
Yeah, I mean, honestly speaking, that's anybody's guess. But if you look at the infectivity of this virus and the fact that we haven't developed the immunity for this virus yet, and there is no vaccine identified for this virus at the moment, I would guess it would take some time. It looks like a long drawn out battle. If you go by the world situation, the steps that are taken by the other countries, we can assume that this is not going to be something that will end in few days or few weeks. Probably in the best case scenario, we may be talking about few months. I may be wrong. I mean, this is anybody's guess, but it will be very safe to assume that this is a long drawn out battle. And as a country, we should be able to coexist and adapt ourselves to this, live with this, and probably the health sector, not only health sector, even education, economics, all other areas, we should develop and think out of the box and adapt measures so that even if this lasts long, because only thing that we can do is keep this situation under control till we become strong enough, immune enough to face this threat.
The news that is coming from the world very clearly indicates that China, as an example, Wuhan was locked down for nearly 3 months, and it's going to be open on the 8th of April. So it was around approximately 3.5 months since the country was on lockdown.
Exactly.
In Sri Lanka, it's the 15th day yet after the partial curfew or the partial lockdown was imposed by the government.
Yes. Yeah.
How long will this go on for? Because you say it's a long battle.
It's a long battle. And again, I would say, yeah, still we are at a very early stage of the spread of the infection. What we can see is, what we are seeing at the moment is the first cluster of patients, the imported cases and the patients who got the disease from them. And all of them can be traced to the links. So what we can say is, at the moment we are seeing the first cluster, and at the moment we are not seeing a community spread. What we mean by that is all the patients currently we are seeing can be traced to particular origin. They can be identified.
So when it's not a community spread, wearing masks are not essential?
Not essential. This is a very contentious area. There's a lot of debate on this. And one thing we have to be very clear is health authorities are not saying that not to wear a mask. What the health authorities are saying